I'm always self-confident, yeah. Otherwise, I stop fighting. When I think I'm gonna lose, I don't fight. But I must save it for the K1. Otherwise, it will be a big problem, I think, in Holland. Those people are a little bit wilder than these people.
Be very late, substitute for the Laszlo Peter Aerts.
I feel like getting old, I think, because I fought the beginning already. As long as I can remember, I fight already. Still want to fight. For me, the feeling I want to fight 10 years more. I cannot do, but I'm still motivated all the time.
On June 23rd, Peter Aerts is headed to the World Grand Prix in Amsterdam. It is impossible to talk about K1 without talking about Peter. But at 37, why does he continue to fight? It is a country filled with the highest level of fighters in the world. But ask any one of them whom they respect, and they'll all tell you one name, the toughest kickboxer of the 20th century, Peter Aerts. Aerts has just entered his 15th year with K1. And when we went to his house for an interview, the first place he showed us was a room close to his heart. His home gym. He installed it so he could spend more time with his family. The walls of this mini museum tell the story of Aerts's history.
This is your whole fighting history?
Yeah.
On the walls?
Yeah. Long time.
He was in K1's first Grand Prix. And as one of K1's current top fighters, Peter Aerts has walked alongside of K1 the whole time. Many times has he basked in the glory of victory, and many times tasted defeat. He has shined as champion an astonishing 3 times, and as K1 enters its 15th year as a sport, it wouldn't be an overstatement to say that Aerts's history is K1's history.
I feel like getting old, I think. Because I fought the beginning already. As long as I can remember, I'm fighting already. For me, I still feel good. I can fight for 3 years for sure, more. And after that time, we'll see what's happening. When it goes good, I continue. When it goes bad, I stop. But we'll see what's happening.
1993. With one devastating high kick, Morris Smith's 8-year undefeated record was undone. In that moment, Peter Aerts put the world on notice, becoming a sensation in the fighting world. He was everyone's clear favorite going into the 1993 Grand Prix. When he faced his first opponent, little-known Ernesto Hoost, everyone expected Aerts to easily win. The outcome, however, defied people's expectations. Against the storm of Hoost's combinations, Peter couldn't find his stride. And ended up losing the match by decision, a loss which jolted through the fighting world. But this one match would do much to shape the future of K1. After defeating Aerts in the first match, Hoost all but decapitated Morris Smith with a high kick. But in the finals, one well-placed punch finished Hoost. And the first championship ever was taken by the virtually unknown fighter, Bronco Sikatic. Pat Ertz defeated Hoost on that day. Perhaps the high kick for which he became so well known might never have been born. And had that been the case, the history of K1 certainly would have been different. With all of the top contenders defeated and a slew of unknown fighters rising to the top, the grueling one-day tournament sent a fire through all who watched it. K1's history began with Ertz's defeat on that day. His immense dedication to practice and commitment to fight is balanced by a devotion to his family. Watching the antics of both his young twins, especially young Marciano, one can't help but be reminded of a younger Ertz.
Yeah, but for them it's normal, because when they were small, I was boxing in my house, they were looking, you know. But the problem is now on school, because they think it's normal, they hit and kick everybody, you know? They think it's normal, they see them every day. But now it's good. First few weeks were bad for him on school, you want to kick everybody? Now it's okay, now he listens.
This loving father wouldn't trade time with his family for anything. His warmth here is at distinct odds with his other side. The first bad boy of Holland, a man who is famed for his fear of nothing. His defeat to Hoost pushed Ertz to make a comeback. He would win back-to-back Grand Prix in 94 and 95, his raw determination clinching 14 fights in a row. In the finals was a young Jerome LeBanner facing Ertz for his first K1 event ever.
J'encontrais mon idole.
Sono toki wa, il était idol pour toi.
Bah ouais.
Bien sûr.
Comme ça.
When talking about Ertz, you can't avoid talking about his finishing move, the high kick. Even today, it's got speed, finesse, and plenty of destructive power. One tournament to go down in history was the 1998 Grand Prix. Ertz won all three matches by first round knockout, destroying his rivals to take his third title. It's hard to say when, but somewhere along the line, he had become known as the toughest kickboxer of the 20th century. This name is backed up by a stellar record. But although time might fly when you're in the spotlight, when you are suffering, it drags on forever. Rewards for fighting were replaced by injury, and Ertz's strength began to wane. Even then, he continued to fight. But he was reaching his limits and was forced to bow out of one fight after another.
Well, when I fight, you know, it depends on what feeling I have, you know. But I'm very well motivated, so I don't care about nothing. I beatified, I think, sometime it was a little bit stupid, but on that moment I only care about winning.
Even then, this three-time champion somehow found it in himself to win a spot in the World Grand Prix. But as he lost to one up-and-coming fighter after another, fewer people saw him as a serious contender. During this time of personal crisis, did Peter ever think of quitting?
No, I never thought. But I got many problems in 96. I got a disease in my stomach and I got some other disease also. So, and I think that was a really bad moment for me. But it made me stronger this moment. When I was finished with that, it made me much stronger. So, but I always wanted to fight. Still want to fight. For me, the feeling I want to fight 10 years more. I don't can, I cannot do, but I'm still motivated all the time.
Currently, Ertz is training with a team of good friends and young fighters who have come seeking to learn from their hero. Also joining his team are two trainers he has worked with closely in the past, Jan Kloss and Tommy Harnik, both men who know Ertz well. Although this is a team that he has put together, in the fight world, each man goes into the ring alone. It is largely because of the training environment that Ertz has built around himself that he continues to be a top K-1 fighter, even at the age of 37. Listening closely to Jan's instructions, Ertz aims to become an even better fighter.
He's very good. He's very experienced trainer. I'm very happy with him. Oh, but the things Jan say, I know. But he's a very good technical fighter, trainer. Technical when you fight, you close your eyes, you can do what he say, it works. You know, you can blind, you can trust it. You know, so but he's technical, very strong. And sure, he's a very experienced guy. And you always, even when you're experienced, a lot of experience, you always make a little mistake. Your step or your small details, you know, and that's important in fighting.
And we get along very well. He understands what I want, and we work really with Tommy Harding together, really as a team together. All the boys are there for each other, and that's the main thing I think with training. It's not only Peter. Everybody helps. Everybody fight. Give him a hard time, and that keeps him sharp in the real fight. In the training, Peter's always relaxed, but in the real fight, different person. I know his limits, but the only thing I knew all the time is he has a fighter spirit, a fighter heart. He's a strong guy, and yeah, Peter is Peter. Let's say Peter is Peter. Like before, I was training with Ernesto, and as the host, Ernesto is different. But still, Peter, he still has a lot of power, and he is, we call him in Dutch, a training animal. He's always training, always, so he's always ready.
People are naturally drawn to Ertz. He has an air of jollity that surrounds him, that puts people instantly at ease. He is a man that other fighters can look up to. One fighter to practice with Team Ertz is Zavit Bayrami, the favorite disciple of 1996 Grand Prix winner Andy Hu. When his teacher, Andy, died from a sudden illness in 2000, few people took it harder than Bayrami. One person to come to his aid in this dark time was Hoog's rival and close friend, Ertz. By bringing Bayrami aboard his team, Ertz helped him make a K-1 comeback. Now, once again, Hoog's disciple joins Ertz's crew with his eyes on the K1 championship. The friendship between Ertz and Hoog was one forged on the K1 battlefield and now continues here. An event that speaks largely of Ertz's character was the stage for Ernesto Hoost's final fight in Holland, the 2006 K1 European Grand Prix. 1 hour before the fight, the unthinkable happened. Hoost's opponent for the fight, Bob Sapp, fled the arena just moments before the fight. And with the main fight in shambles, the event itself was in jeopardy. It was at this moment that one man came to the rescue. There at the event as a guest commentator, Ertz offered to step into the ring.
I decided to save the gala. For me, normally I don't fight, you know. But I must save it for the K1. Otherwise, it will be a big problem, I think, in Holland. Those people are a little bit wilder than in Japan.
It's not about the ticket or the invitation for your
fans. No, yeah, sure. I want some extra, you know, but when I don't fight, you know, for me it's a risk too. Maybe you knock me out. Because I'm in a totally bad shape. But I must save the gala, I think, you know. And for K1 is good when I do.
The tournament finished safely. When K1 was in need, it was Ertz's quick action that came to the rescue.
I did something. I didn't do too much, but to save the K1.
I have respect for every fighter. Everybody who goes in the ring deserves respect, I think, because...
To get into the ring is a difficult job, but Ertz does it with an easygoing appeal that goes beyond just his achievements and experience. An appeal that has won the admiration of not only fighters, but many fans around the world. He went into the fight with Hoost at the tournament with no preparation, and even had to borrow trunks from Simi Schilt for the fight. Simi is another fighter who looks up to Ertz, and whose participation in the Holland tournament has been set once again this year. Back-to-back winner of the World Grand Prix and first ever super heavyweight champion, Schilt is one opponent everyone is looking out for.
He's not a perfect fighter because the problem is his height. Technically, he's not a good boxing, I think. He's getting better.
Last March, Ertz faced Juggernaut Schilt for the first time and won.
That was close, I think. But when you hit it him hard, he's a little bit panicked, I think. So that's the weak thing of him. But his physical is very strong, you know. So it's difficult. You have to pressure him. Otherwise, he can't never stop punching and kicking, you know.
And who would you like to fight against next?
Simi Schultz, K1 Grand Prix champion.
The brightest star this year, Mighty Mo. At the USA Grand Prix in April, he knocked one opponent down after another to win the tournament. And this year, he's KO'd his way to a staggering six straight victories. But undoubtedly, his fight with the biggest impact was his March victory over the towering Hong Man Choi. He sank an opponent taller than Simi Schilt to the mat with his blistering right hook. Schilt himself experienced his first knockdown in K1 ever in this matchup with Ray Seppo.
Simi is better than Hong Man Choi. Technically, he's not good. But he stays dangerous.
Ertz, who has faced Mo in the ring, had this to say about the power of Mighty's right hand.
You think his strong point is the right hook?
Yeah, when he touches it. When he don't touch
it. Does that mean that that's his only strong point?
He will never can knock him out with kicks or those things. It will be right hook. It's only possibility.
aired Chut Mighty Moe's main weapon down, never giving it a chance to connect. It was low kicks that finished the fight.
Mighty Moe has a knockout punch. It was 5 rounds. I think when he don't knock him out, Sammy will win because of his condition and his height. But when he touches one time, he can be over Mighty Moe. That's the problem, I think.
If the fight goes through, it will be the biggest matchup this year and certainly one of the most anticipated. Ertz was on a roll last year, and his place in the Grand Prix was all but insured. However, a sudden illness destroyed his shot at the final elimination. He recovered to secure a berth in the tournament as a reserve fighter, but his chances of making it to the finals were slim. Had everything gone according to plan, Ertz would have fought Remy Bonjasky in the final elimination.
Without Peter, I think I wouldn't be here fighting in the K1.
Bonjasky began his fighting career the same year Ertz clinched back-to-back championships in 95. His greatest wish is to become strong like Ertz, be a champion like Ertz. Well, wishes do come true, and Bonjasky himself became a fighter of world renown. In last year's Grand Prix, however, Bonjasky's luck would abandon him in his attempt to win a third championship title.
Exclamation mark. He got stamped, go for the jawline of Bonjasky.
Disaster struck in the quarterfinals. Through great determination, he would win the round, but the damage was too great, and he had to forfeit. It was Ertz whom Lady Luck's light would shine on. After winning his reserve fight, he took Bonjasky's place in the semis, where he overpowered Glauby Feitoza and made it to his first finals in 7 years. The fortunes of Ertz and Bonjasky went in two very different directions, and the world has yet to see them face off.
He's a great fighter, he's a great person. We've trained a lot together. I mean, we've trained, I think, almost 3 years together. But in the ring, yeah, it's what you do. It's work, you know? You love to doing that, but if I let him win from me, he will be the top, you know?
What is Ertz's take on Bonjasky, a fighter who follows in his footsteps?
He's a good fighter, I think. Depends on the motivation he has, you know. When he's motivated, he can be very good. So I have to take care of him for sure. His physical strong points. I think he's all around. He can box. His kicks and his knees are the best, I think, in this thing. But he's all around. He can do everything. He can kick. He can punch. So I have to watch everything, I think.
Ertz's opponent has yet to be announced, but for this man who continues to give it his all, it doesn't matter who he will face. For Ertz fights for himself, for his family, and of course, for K1.
I was always like this. I was always, everybody with me, they have a hard fight. Everybody knows. So, but I'm always self-confident, you know. Otherwise, I stop fighting. When I think I'm going to lose, I don't fight.
I think he still has the possibility to be the champion again. This time it was close, but he was in the head, not really prepared for that. But we will see this year how it ends. I hope that he stays healthy and that he don't have heavy damage. But if not, I think he's still able to win the K1.
Or how did you motivate yourself?
Love for the sport. I love the sport. I love the excitement. For me, when I didn't fight now for half a year, I really don't feel good.
To Ertz, K1 is...
K1, yeah. It's my life. I was always at K1, I built up K1. In the beginning, there were not many people. Not many people know it. So from the beginning there, and I say a long time till the empire.
Ertz's fight continues.